Oh, hello there. Welcome back to the Agostinho Zinga Show with me, your host, Agostinho Zinga. This is episode number 246. That's dos, cuatro, seis. Dos, cuatro, seis. How you guys doing, man? How you feeling? Amazing. Good to hear. And how am I? Pretty good, man. As you can tell, I've just arrived back from the old day-to-day 9-to-5 occupation. I've got my work clothes on at the moment. Because, you know, I couldn't get my podcast done in the morning. Because guess what? Guess what? Time went by, innit? Stuff to do, people to see, deals to secure, hands to shake, babies to kick, puzzles to run into, traffic to run across, right? Barriers to jump over or jump under, depending on how agile you are and depending on your ability to reenact those parkour moves you saw in that shitty French movie you saw one time. So much stuff to do, man. I was so busy, so I didn't have time to do it this morning. But, you know, here I am now, live and direct. Hope you guys are doing well. As you can tell, I actually don't mind looking at myself at this in camera. It actually doesn't mind too bad. If you're listening to the podcast app, I've got like a black jacket on, a black jumper, some sunglasses and my hair that I haven't cut in a while. I think I'm going to probably let my hair grow out a little bit more. My beard, as you can tell here from the video, look, I think the barber took too much off, so I'm going to try and regrow it, and hopefully when I go back he can just trim the edges exactly and not actually trim it to... It's annoying when they do that, isn't it? It's annoying when you go to a barbershop, you ask them to do something and they do complete opposite. Happens quite often. I know it's a common complaint of women when they go to salons. Usually though, from what I've heard of people who are hairstylists, most women or most people that go into hair salons have unrealistic expectations of how their hair is going to turn out, especially if they come in there with a picture from a celebrity. Like, oh, I want to look like Angelina Jolie. And it's like, yeah, but your hair isn't like that. Do you know what I mean? It's not going to sit the same way. So it's a stylist's job to kind of, you know, consult with their client and go back and forth until you find a solution. But when you're going into like a flipping regular, you know, yard man, African guy, Turkish dude, Asian guy, white guy, barber, for men usually, it's always the same shit, right? Usually you're getting a buzz cut on the side, some sort of fade, you're trimming the top, or you're getting it trimmed up, you're getting maybe some gel in it. There's not much, you know, much to play with in men's hair for the most part. So you'd expect them to just do what you want, innit? Especially with dudes, we're quite, I know with me when it comes to haircuts, I'm pretty, do you know what I mean? I have my two or three trims I go for, maybe a little tape on the edges, maybe a shape up, and then maybe the skin fade, the high skin fade, but that's about it. Maybe the fourth is maybe like the faux mohawk thing where you sort of like tape it in and you leave a bit at the back. But I don't have many. That's all I have, right? And I know they look good on me because I get the same haircuts again and again and again. It's the reason why I don't chop off the top of my hair, because, you know, I know how I look. I know my head looks like a flipping 50 pence piece when I chop off the hair. And now at the top, I've got an oblong shaped head. People used to say I have my head shaped like a condom back in the day in school. So that gives you all the idea that you need about why my hair's so big at the top. But I know what I like, innit? So when we go to a barbershop, you expect the barber to be like, okay, cool, Agostinho, how can I help you today? I say, hey, barber, can you give me A, B, C, and D? And they always end up somehow fucking up A, missing the B, and doing something else completely different on C and D. And you just have to swallow it as a dude. You just have to swallow it. You don't complain. Stiff up a lip, right? as we are Brits here. You give the person your money, and guess what? Like a bitch, you come back again the following week. And you come back again the following week because you got nowhere else to go. So I'm going to do this thing that I used to do back in the day where I'm going to grow out my hair, and I'm going to go there and I'm going to tell them what I want it to look like, right? Or even, you know what I might do, actually? I might go back and tell them not to touch my beard at all. Just leave it completely as it is. And then just kind of shave the sides, make sure the corners are done. But just don't touch my beard. Just leave it. I don't mind actually growing it and making it look a bit raggedy. Because I feel I'm a bit fed up of the whole, like, you know, edges and sharpening on the side. I think it looks a little bit weird. There's something a bit strange in it. I think ever since Crystal Leah mentioned it, I can't unsee it now. The sharp edges, like you're cutting your hair, and I mean, it just looks a bit strange. I'm just gonna let it grow out, especially the bottom as well. Let it kind of fade out a little bit, and then have the top kind of well done. But then I think the top as well needs to be braided. It's getting too long now. I need to do something with my hair. I need to braid it in some way, shape, or form. I think I might go for this look. Right, I saw some. What's that basketball player's name? Damn it. Or even the game, innit? The game had some quite cool braids. The game braids, right? You got braids on the top. I forgot what it was like. It was looked pretty nice. I think I might get that same sort of haircut. And I think Lil Uzi Vert had the same sort of thing, right? So it's like this. This is what I might get. If you're listening via the YouTube app, then the podcast app, then I apologize. But essentially, it's like an Omarion haircut where you kind of shave the sides and then you give yourself this on the top. So I think this is what I might end up going for. the kind of braids on top of it might look pretty cool, as you can see there on that picture. And that barber shop, that barber that's actually cutting the game's hair, looks really, really cool as well. Yeah, I think I might go for that, actually. That looks amazing. I'm a big fan of that. Because I think my hair is too long now just to leave it as it is. I need some kind of assistant on top, like something like that. Do you know what I mean? Fade with braids, as they call it. I was trying to type in what it was, but it's actually called fades with braids. So I didn't need to do anything else. But yeah, that looks pretty cool. I like the way that it looks. So I'm going to probably do that sometime very soon. Hopefully, again, I don't go to... Because, you know, there's a constant fucking battle to find out. How do people find out where to go to get stuff like this done? Do you just Google braids in London? Like, what do you do? If you want to have a good haircut, if you want to have the haircuts like, you know, like the game has in this picture, right? Those kind of American fades, right? Where it's super sharp and it fades in and all corners are amazing. Where do you go? How do you find out who does that in London? How do you find out who braids your hair in London? So I'm going to have to go to some... I'm going to have to go to an auntie to braid my hair. Then I'm going to have to go to another barbershop to cut my hair. It's just an absolute madness, isn't it? I wish it could all be done just in one place. But unfortunately, no bueno. So yeah, that's what I'm aiming to do the next couple of weeks. Hopefully get that done. But yeah, you know, this is my day-to-day wares as I am. But no, you know what, actually? If anyone's got any recommendations about where I can go and get some braids done at the top, especially around East London, and where I can get a haircut in the same place, that'll be advantageous. So if, you know, I can just sit down, get my hair all did up, like this, like how is it? Is that Quincy Jones? That's Quincy Jones, right? I think maybe Quincy Jones, but get my hair done up like that on the top, so kind of braids on the top, and then skin fade on the side. If anyone in London knows where I can get that done, I don't care about East London. Anywhere in London, that's really good. Please send pictures. Please send me links, or let me know the people, and I'll Google them myself. Leave me a comment down below. That'd be awesome. And if you're listening to a podcast app, send me an email, man. Send me an email. Reach out at Agostinho Zinga or agostinotz@me.com. That's agostinotz@me.com. I'll put that link in the show notes for you as well. And if you have any tips, bring a man in, man. Bring me in, man. Let me look light-skinned, 6'2", with green eyes, man. You know what I mean? Let me floss 1 minute. You know what I mean? What else is happening with me? Oh, yeah. I actually don't mind wearing this. I think I've gone. Someone already asked me of... I've been asked already, like, do I wear the same thing every day? And it's like, yeah, a combination of, do you know what I mean? I've got 3 or 4 of these jumpers. I've got a million black t-shirts and this jacket I continually wear. But I'm starting to really enjoy dressing in a particular uniform every day of the week, especially when I'm going to work, especially if I'm working 9 to 5. If you're living the YouTuber creative lifestyle, then maybe it's a bit different. It's quite cool to mix things up. But I think the monotony of the everyday going to work, I'd rather not be stressed out and thinking about what my outfits are going, you know. Again, this is, you know, first world problems, because I actually give a shit about clothes, but because I care about my appearance and I care about clothes, I don't want to make myself go crazy by worrying about my outfit. So I'd rather just have a set outfit I wear during the week, and then if I want to kind of ball out on the Thursday or on the Friday after work, because we're going to go after work drinks, I can do that. But for the most part, I got that locked down, so all my other brain capacity could be used, you know, doing stuff like this, DJing, writing, whatever it may be called. I got room in my head to kind of do other things, as opposed to using up all my RAM just to figure out what I'm going to wear during the week, which is, you know, it doesn't really matter, really, because you're going to be sat in your chair for 8 hours anyway. Do you know what I mean? But who cares? So as long as I've got something quite nice on that, I don't mind going. Something that, again, this is a bit of a neutral look, isn't it? It's a black sort of like motorcycle biker jacket, wax jacket, some jumper, and black trousers, my socks and loafers. So it's a pretty neutral look. It can work in most places. I'm not overdressed. I'm not underdressed. That's the main thing you don't want to have, right? You don't want to be underdressed when you go anywhere. You don't want to be overdressed when you go anywhere. I still remember that feeling of turning up to Alibi on a Sunday, or no, I think it might be like a Saturday after I went to church or something, and turning up in my full church attire. And this is just, imagine, right? When I used to hang out around East London, or especially that whole era, it was very much an all-encompassing world. It wasn't necessarily a thing. Yeah, it was quite its own thing, right? You didn't necessarily, like, the people I hanged out with at the Alibi or during my party promoter days, they were a specific group of people, right? They were all the kind of, you know, for lack of a better term, they were all the caners, right? So there were people that worked in bars, people that were artists, people that were in bands, people that were promoters themselves, people that were working in the creative field, just all those kind of people. That's who I hanged out with. But it's rarely that you would mix that group of people with your fashion friends, or with your trainer friends, or with your friends from back home, or with your friends from church. So it was all quite separate. So they saw different sides of you. And maybe that my friends also had the same thing on their side, right? But I remember it being a big deal when I went to Alibi in smart clothes, because effectively no one had seen me in trousers that fit, right? in shoes that were had hard soles that clicked and clacked as you walked, and in a tucked in shirt. No one see me that way, so it just looked like, what the fuck is this dude? Everything looked bizarre. It's like when you see the bartender out one day, she's on a date and she's all glammed up and got a dress on. You're like, wow, you know, because you always used to see them in jeans with the fucking, you know, bottle opener in the back of their pockets, or when you see a security guard in normal clothing. Do you know what I mean? It's just, he's a blow your mind. That's like the adult version of seeing your teacher on a weekend in Westfield. Do you know what I mean? Fucking hell, that ain't that sir. It's like, yeah, sir has a life. He's going to go get a burger at Shake Shack. Like, leave him alone. So that used to be a common thing, but yeah, I don't mind, man. I don't mind doing this during the week. I mean, I've got nowhere else to go, really. I'm limiting my drinking, especially during the week. I don't drink at all now at the moment during the week. Just trying to keep it to the weekends and big parties and stuff. And, you know, in and out like a ninja at work, and making sure I do all my other stuff outside of work. And that is where I have a balanced and fulfilled life. So the last thing I want to do is be worrying about what trousers I'm wearing. It's not that serious, you know what I mean? The main thing I need to do is bring my A game when I'm stepping to that occupation where I am, innit? Because they're the ones obviously keeping the lights on. Know what I mean? You got to respect them places. But yeah, here I am, man. Hope you guys are well rested and all that sort of stuff. I'm good. I'm feeling live. Let's get into some topics. Stuff I've seen on the internet. Stuff I've been thinking about speaking about here and all that other good stuff. Yeah? Yeah? Cool. All right. So what do we have here? Is it 246 or is it episode 247? I think this might be 247, you know. Is it 247? Let me just make sure. I think I might have this one wrong as per usual. I think I might have got this wrong. Maybe this is episode 247. Let me check and see. Because if it is, then I apologize. If you're listening, this is episode 246. I mess up the intro, as I always do. But hey, you know what? Stuff happens. Come on, where is this flipping? Why can't I see this? It's taking ages to load. Maybe I've got too much stuff open, haven't I? Okay, I've got to shut some stuff down, it looks like. Okay, cool. So, it looks like we are 246. We are. Okay, cool. Thank God. All right, let's do this. Let's go through some topics. I've got loads of stuff to talk about, and I want to talk about it with you guys. So, first things first. I saw this, right? This is Diane Vreeland, one of the former editors of fashion editors of Vogue, I'm pretty sure, from back in the day. There's a really cool article here from Harper's Bazaar that kind of details her secrets. And I thought, looking at it, that the first thing that came to mind is that there might be a certain hip-hop rapper out there who could probably do with taking the cue of Diane Vreeland's creative direction or taste, or just the way that she kind of puts pictures together. And I would hope you guys have an idea of what I mean, right? So I've got this up here on screen. This is an article from Harper's Bazaar, Diane Vreeland's Secrets. The subtext is the legendary fashion editor and the subject of a new documentary, Diane Vreeland, never ceases to astound, right? And if you scroll and look at a picture, what do you see in this picture? You see, and if I'm describing it via to you on a podcast app, essentially it's an older woman who looks incredibly well put together. She has an amazing lace sort of fabric dress on, and she's kind of lying on a massive vintage sofa with a range of tapestry and knickknacks and vases and lamps and chairs and all crazy amounts of furniture all around her. But there's one thing tying it all together: the color red. And I thought, you know what would make a good cover for this? Playboi Carti's new album, A Whole Lotta Red, that was due to come out a while back. We haven't heard about it. We don't know when it's going to come out, but I think this would be a pretty cool album cover for Diane Vreeland. Imagine Playboi Carti did his kind of version of this Diane Vreeland, an image. I think that'd be pretty cool. Like, imagine just him maybe in like maybe a bit more of a modern apartment, maybe with a lot more other trinkets around, and then him completely covered in red clothing, maybe eating a red velvet cake or something. That'd be flipping sick. Or something along those kind of like, or just sitting there. But then maybe that'd be similar to the image on the self-titled album, right? That's where he's kind of like, there's two girls beside him, and he's like, what is he, cutting through a paper or smoking something? But yeah, I think that would look pretty cool. I think Playboi Carti, A Whole Lotta Red, I think he should take that idea. So yeah, feel free to take that for free, my friend. Playboi Carti, if that means we get the album sooner than rather than later, I'll be more than happy. But yeah, I reckon that would be really cool for him. But anyway, the article says the following. It's a pretty cool one. It says, when I married, who wrote this article, actually? Lisa Imodino Vreeland. So let's read this article quickly. So here's Diane Vreeland's secrets, right? When I married Alexander Vreeland, Whenever I was Diane Vreeland, this is Diane Vreeland's word. I'd never imagined that I would spend 3 years documenting his legendary grandmother, magazine editor and tastemaker, fashion icon, but I was driven by the idea of honoring her unique creative genius. During a 20-year... Oh, she was a Harper's Bazaar editor, my bad, not Vogue. During a 26-year tenure Harper's Bazaar, Diana didn't just clothe women. She presented them with aspirations, artful ideas, and the possibility of a glamorous self, which is amazing, isn't it? That's what you want, to live a life, to live a life just kind of drenched and covered in creativity. Every single day, the only thing you think about is art. Your whole life is art. The way you eat is art. No, the way you wake up is art. What you do when you wake up is art. The things that you eat, how you work out, what you work out with, what you're doing when you're working out. Everything's some sort of an artistic dance. That's what I'm kind of about at the moment. I think maybe this is my version of it, this uniform that I'm wearing day in, day out. It's my artistic dance. It's my 1-2-2-step-2-1-1-2-2. I don't know, maybe it isn't. Who knows? It continues here. Richard Avedon said, after her death in 1989, she was and remains the only genius and fashion editor. I interviewed more than 60 people for my documentary, The Eyes Has to Travel. I'm definitely going to watch that, including her two sons, Tim and Frederick, and my husband and his brother, Nicholas, shared wonderful child memories of the time spent with their nonina. If there was one common thread, it was that Diana's vision inspired people to push forward their own lives. I discovered many interesting things about her during her research. Here are the 15 of them. Okay, awesome. I'd love being that kind of person. You know that kind of person where you turn up to an airport and you're never in sweats. You're always kind of done to the T, like in a fucking amazing suit. Like you just look incredible. That's what I want to do when I grow up. I want to be that person that goes, you know, mundane task. You're like, you know, you've got a full fucking, you know, Bottega Veneta outfit on. Do you know what I mean? You're wearing your favorite Celine jacket. You know, you've got these fucking crazy suede leather, I don't know, sandals on from Prada, just, you know, popping down the street to go to the GP. I want that vibe. But here's some of the interesting things she picked along the lines of Diane Vreeland. Number one, pillows in her home were infused with perfume via hypodermic needles. That's amazing. Number two, before coming a fashion editor, Diana had a lingerie shop in London. Legend has it that Wallace Simpson seduced Edward, then Prince of Wales, while wearing one of Diana's nightgowns. Mum's store bought down the British Empire, her son Friedrich once joked. She even had one nightgowns tailored with up to 3 fittings on someone's single one. A nightgown, tailored nightgown. Imagine now, that is just amazing. I love that kind of opulence. Number three, she always had her dollar bills and her tissues ironed before putting them in her handbag. Oh, this woman's too much. She ate the same lunch every day. A whole wheat peanut butter and marmalade sandwich washed down with scotch. Jesus, I wonder what that must taste like. Peanut butter and marmalade with scotch. That combo must be a bit strange, isn't it? Sounds cool though. I'll try it out. Peanut butter is the greatest invention since Christianity, she said. Number five, she rarely left the house before noon. She often conducted her serious business from her tub. Number six, only thing Diana loved more than fashion was reading. Her favorite book was Moby Dick. My life has been more influenced by books than by any other thing in life. Yes, books, reading and books. I've got too many down here, as you can see. I'm a big proponent of books. I try not to preach about it too much now because I just think, you know, you rub people's faces in it and they think that you're, you know, you're intellectually masturbating yourself. And just in general, it's a selfless thing. Something I do particularly with the stuff that I read. It's for my own self-interest. It doesn't really need to go outside of my brain, and you know, yeah, it's just not fun really. What else she had here that's interesting? Oh, Diane's favorite color is red, but she never found the perfect shade, which was, according to her, the color of a child's cap in any of his Renaissance portrait. Interesting. But yeah, I recommend check it out. I'm not gonna read the whole list on it because that'll make for a boring podcast, but check it out. Harper's Bazaar, Diane Vreeland's Secrets. I'll link it actually in the show notes for you guys that want to see it. And you guys can have a look. And obviously, watch the documentary too. The documentary is called The Eye Has to Travel. I'm sure some people have watched it. I'm sure it's available on Netflix and stuff, isn't it? It probably is, right? Is it available on Netflix? Let me have a look. See if it is available on Netflix. It probably might be, actually. I don't know. The Eye Has to Travel, huh? No! Oh, what are you doing? The Eye Has... All right. Like that. So, The Eye Has to Travel. Yeah, it's available on YouTube and Google Play, wherever you get your documentaries from. Also, you know, wink wink, nudge nudge. But yeah, let's move on from that one. What else do we want to see here? What's on the list? Let's move along. Oh, this one article here says supposedly streetwear is losing its edge. It's a little snippet of an article from High Snobiety. I think the full article is on the business of fashion, but it's behind a paywall, and obviously I'm not going to pay that. So I'm going to read a bit of what I saw from High Snobiety, and then I guess we can kind of take it from there and kind of surmise where they're currently going or what direction they think they're playing at, or what they're playing at in general, because I don't think it's actually true. I don't think there is a streetwear lost its edge. I think maybe the fashion industry's maybe got tired of streetwear, right? They might have kind of moved on to bigger and brighter things, but I think for the most part, the idea of kids rebelling and starting their own brands and printing, screen printing on t-shirts, getting caps embroidered, making their own perfect version of a baseball cap, that will never, ever, ever, ever die, in my opinion. But who, what do I know? Let's get this article up here and then we can kind of discuss this further, because, you know, what's the point of saying all this stuff if you can't prove it, innit? So let's get up on here. 1 second. Let me see if I can find where is this article here. So this article from High Snobiety. Of course, it's got the godfather of streetwear himself on the main image there, Hiroshi Fujiwara. It says the following. This is a headline. Hiroshi Fujiwara and others discuss what happens once the streetwear bubble bursts. Hiroshi Fujiwara and Raf Simons are just some of the huge industry talents spotlighted in a new piece from Business of Fashion, which discusses what future could look like once the streetwear bubble bursts, right? And I guess that mostly comes from the idea that there was a time, maybe it was a good, let's say, what was that fashion? What was the introduction? I probably said introduction of Vetements. Vetements for me maybe marked the beginning of the explosion of streetwear on fashion runway shows, right? Remember that Vetements show? Let me see if I can find it, actually. Let me get that up first, and then we can discuss the rest of it. Vetements Vogue. Let's see. Why is it being so weird and stuff when I've closed everything down? Let me close that down. Let me close this down. Let me close that down. Okay, cool. So let me see all the... Let's get a Vetements collection up on here, right? And I think this is where, for me personally, where I think the streetwear wave came tumbling down, or where the initial spark started from, in my opinion, right? So that Vetements show that everyone went to, where it was in like a weird underground nightclub somewhere in the middle of Paris. That was the one where Gerard Leto, Jerry Lorenzo, Kanye West, Virgil, and a few other people are sitting next to each other. That was fall winter 2015. Do you remember that show? That was kind of the famous one, the second show after the first, or maybe the third collection, because I remember they had the first collection where all the models were up on plimps, but that was like a lookbook only. Then we had the first collection where it was mostly kind of, you know, sweat kind of singlets or onesies. And then we had this first collection, which I've got on screen here, fall winter 2015, that had all the little kind of security badge holder things on the clips. This is the collection that had the boots. This collection that had that massive bomber jacket that Rihanna was wearing and everyone was wearing for a while. That huge oversized bomber jacket everyone was wearing that was just popular all over the place. And loads of Korean band people started wearing. Do you remember this? I think this was a start for me of when streetwear really went like full force within the fashion scene. Before that, it didn't really feel like streetwear was kind of an integral part. Again, that's probably my understanding from it. I don't know if you guys agree with it, but that's why I think streetwear kind of really kind of infiltrated. And ever since then, other brands have tried to do their own shitty version of it, some worse than others. You know, you've got brands like Michael Kors and Coach and all these kind of garbage brands deciding to implement streetwear elements in their fashion that doesn't really work as well. And you've got some of the other higher brow brands like maybe Prada and stuff, who are, you know, obviously Rakesh Prada is like a genius and a once in a lifetime talent, but you know, there is a bit of a disconnect when it comes to the youth market. So when a streetwear wave did come about, it felt like a convenient time for them to kind of, you know, fully lean into bringing back some of the more sportier elements of Prada and then connecting that with the maybe streetwear element of it. But you know, the quintessential Vetements hoodie, down jacket element, you know, this doesn't get more quintessential streetwear than basically what we're seeing now, right? There's a pre-appropriation of motorcycle pants back into the mainline again, loads of really cool streetwear elements. There's this massive bomber jacket I mentioned that everyone was wearing for a while, the football inspired scarves, like loads of interesting bits that obviously I'm more sure you guys are aware of. So let's get back to the article and hear what they have to say about it. So the article says the following. The extensive piece looks at the situation from both sides of the coin. Firstly, it addresses the fact that streetwear has been largely misrepresented as a trend rather than a reflection of the street and youth culture, which I 100% agree on. Secondly, it highlights what today's top designers believe is coming next. There was this real big... I got a bit annoyed with it, and I thought it was a bit of a kick in the face or a slap to the face when everyone, all the fashion editors, were trying to push it. Some, or maybe because some of those designers in their notes were putting down, like, what's the inspiration for the show? They were writing down things to do with tailoring, that sort of stuff, right? Tailoring, shape, fabrication. Loads of things that they think are out of reach from the regular streetwear designer. But the actual fact of the matter is that when you're a streetwear brand, or you're somebody that's, you know, obsessed with streetwear as I am, you're not necessarily bothered about, you know, you don't really care about trying to compete with your favorite fashion brand. You're kind of doing your own little thing. You're kind of taking the staples that you normally have in your own wardrobe and expounding it as you please, or reinterpreting it as you please, right? Most of the high level, or most of the top brands in streetwear, take example for the hoodie, the basic pullover hoodie, most of the top brands in the world that you deem the top streetwear brands out there, they will have a different version of the hoodie, right? Everyone's got a different shape, a different weight, different finish, different trim detail. Everyone's got a different way of kind of reinterpreting that same thing, but they make it season in, season out, and customers like myself keep buying it and buying it, but not necessarily trying to compare that hoodie to like a hoodie from you get to from Celine, or you get from Dolce & Gabbana, or you might get from Gucci. We don't care about that sort of stuff. I always thought that you go to the higher, or you go to the kind of quote unquote luxury brands for what they can offer, and then you go to your streetwear brands for what they can offer. The moment they started to bleed into each other and started to swap notes, or you got streetwear brands who are producing a run of 30 t-shirts because they decided to do it cut and sew, and then they're marking it up to the same price as a Balenciaga tee, that was when they started to get a bit ridiculous. Like, come on, dude, do you know what I mean? We know it's not the same thing. We know it isn't. I come to you for your $60 t-shirts, and I go to them for their £500 trainers, right? They're both, you know, operate on different ends of the totem pole, but they're both completely necessary. Anyway, let's continue the article. Ralph Simmons, for example, said that there are too many hoodies with prints on them out there. Really, Ralph? Really? Did you not contribute anything to it? Do you not think your amazing talent to somehow be able to disseminate to some, your ability to take what you see on the streets, take what you see in youth culture, and then somehow funnel it back into your fashion brands, and then lead to you putting out seminal, iconic, sometimes archival pieces of fashion way ahead of its time that goes on to inspire a generation of designers who then go into do what? Copy or follow in the footsteps of your work? Do you not think you play any role in that? Imagine the hypocrisy of that. Rasim is saying there's too many hoodies out there. Dude, you made some of the best hoodies out there. People are still copying your hoodies now. Like, you contributed to it. And hoodies are an amazing... Hoodies are probably one of them... Hoodies are... Is that a male version of, like, a blouse? Or, like, you know that... What's that... What's that dress in Zara that all the girls wear with the polka dots? That's our version of it. That's a guy's version, right? That kind of style of dress... Most girls can. The reason why it's so popular because it's a dress that is very versatile, and it, you know, it works on most body shapes. And for the most part, most girls or most women would be interested in wearing something like that, right? It touches most of the most people. It covers a wide demographic of people. And I guess maybe a bomber jacket, maybe a leather jacket, not leather jacket, because, you know, I don't think most people want to look like they came out of Greece or something, right? But I think for the most part, most dudes could wear a hoodie, a pullover hoodie in a great material. With a nice comfy hood on it, some cozy pockets you can put your hands in. I think most dudes can fit another one in their wardrobe. I know I could if someone gave me a decent hoodie, even if I got one for free somewhere. I'd definitely rock it. So I don't. Anyway, that's mad, isn't it? Raf Simmons saying there's too many hoodies out there with prints on them. Like, what? You inspired all the kids to do that because you're an amazing designer. Oh. Anyway, well, back to the spring 2019 show, calling for a new outline, a new shape, and Tankoon Panigul feels that tailored clothes are the new streetwear. No, they're not. Tailored clothes are not new streetwear. Streetwear is streetwear, and tailored clothes are tailored clothes. What is wrong with these fashion people? Why are they so... Do you think it's... Could you say this is like dog whistling for like them trying to get all the minorities out of fashion? Could that be a thing? Could it be like they were annoyed that streetwear became like a big deal in fashion, which then invited a whole bevy of influencers, photographers, scene people who looked nothing like your conventional fashion crowd, and maybe they're fed up and they're annoyed of having, first of all, it was the bloggers take up their spaces, and now it's the influencers, and now it's all the scene kids who take up all the rooms in the first couple of rows, right? They're getting flown around everywhere. They're getting all the care packages. Maybe that's the problem with these fashion brands. They just want it to go back to how it was again, right? Make fashion great again or something, that kind of stuff. Oh, God, am I too, sorry about that. Mad noise. But yeah, I wonder what that's about, and that's weird, isn't it? Tailoring isn't a new streetwear. No, it isn't. Anyway, meanwhile, Michiro Kubo, owner, creative director, and head. Do you need to put all those titles in your thing? Can't you just say one thing? People streetwear as well, they love to whack off, innit? On their own ego, innit? Like, they love a good multi-hyphenate. They love a good slash. I think streetwear is the only industry where someone will definitely tell you every job they do, innit? You've never met anyone in streetwear who kind of lays low and you find out through like a third party, oh, you know what? That guy or girl, they're the blah, blah, blah of Marushi. They will definitely tell you, right, within the first couple of seconds. Owner, creative director, head buyer. Okay, cool, man. We, you know, whatever, innit? I think in startup world, if you're the founder, we just assume you're going to be involved in the marketing. I don't think there's not one startup I've been to where the CEO or founder doesn't put his nose or her nose in everything. It's just part of the parcel of having, you know, having your own company, innit? I guess, innit? It's what it is. What can you do? Anyway, what else we got here? Yep, concept. What does he feel like? Dunno, doesn't say what he says. Fujiwara is quoted as saying that streetwear is getting captured by the luxury fashion and is losing his edge. This is why I agree with Gabe. That's why he's a godfather, right? That's what's happening. Fashion is sucking up streetwear. It's taking away its cool points. It's fucking, you know, it's presenting this glitzy, glamoury world. All the streetwear kids, all the streetwear guys who have been slogging and slaving down below, in the depths of streetwear alleys, you know, picking up, you know, measly amounts of money, not selling much t-shirts. Suddenly, when all these fancy lads of the fashion world, models and editors and agents and people with, unlimited amounts of blow and drinks are offering an opportunity to come in and collaborate or have their brands talked at Dover Street Market, I don't have any problem with them accepting that, right? And thinking, you know what, fuck this streetwear life, fuck going to, you know, what's that place in, Bread and Butter in Berlin or something, and standing around with a bunch of dudes, you know, trying to sell your line sheet at a trade show. I'd much rather go to Paris Fashion Week, hang around, not sell anything, but at least be around, mixy, do a couple of lines and have a couple of glasses of wine, innit? That makes probably more sense. But unfortunately, when that happens, the streetwear that we know and love, the one that kind of pokes fun at the establishment, the one that's kind of risque, the one that's always pushing the limits, loses edge. But then fashion spits it back out again in this pasteurized, lacking in any sort of real umph fashion way, right? You remember when when Versace put out that fucking collection with the fake bondage t-shirts? Remember Donatella decided that she wanted to take inspiration from, you know, the underground electronic BDSM counterculture in the whole like techno scene, and decided to put all like kind of, you know, straps and harnesses all over a t-shirt, a print. And the print didn't even go all the way around. It kind of stopped at the hemline of the it's like a print. It was like a digital transfer print. Like, it's like, what the fuck is this, man? These people. So yeah, streetwear needs to be careful. Don't dance too close to the sun. Do you know what I mean? Don't get too close to the fashion world. Dip in, dip out. Get yourself a model or two. You know, console on a couple of, you know, shoots and whatever it may be. Provide them with insights on, you know, why they should use that belt instead of that belt. But, you know, don't go too far. However, in the article continues, however, Hirofumi Kuruni, co-founder and creative director of the retail giant United Arrows, says that the true streetwear stalwarts won't be leaving their edge behind. Exactly. Of course, streetwear is on its way down, but if you are a real skater and you want a nice want a nice sweatshirt or trainers, you continue to buy streetwear. Exactly. There we go. It might be going down in popularity with the general consumer, but the people that will go and buy Dimes or Yard Sale or Awake or Stussy or Supreme even, and all these kind of quintessential streetwear brands that you see season in, season out, Pleasures, Paradise, Grind, they're always going to be around. People are always going to want some cool t-shirts with a cool graphic on it, a good hoodie, a good down jacket as well. A lot of brands are putting out some fucking awesome down jackets too at the moment. Loads of cool tracksuits, right? Some cool socks, a little waist bag. Everyone's always going to want those kind of things. So the fashion people can go dance somewhere else if they want to. But, you know, I'm always going to stay there. And it continues. Anything that reaches its peak has to go down. It continues. It's the fashion cycle. But streetwear is still a daily close to me. So nothing has peaked. Streetwear doesn't change. The peak is people that want new things, which is no one cares about. And then here goes. That point is echoed by Hashtag Bias Christopher Morinci, who told Business of Fashion that it's misconception that streetwear is a trend. Surface level adaptation of streetwear is not what the way of dress stands for. If the kids dress more formally tomorrow, more intelligent, this should not be considered a streetwear, of course. But I don't really get what the point is there. But hey, yeah, all in all, I agree with most of the points there. You can read the whole thing on Business of Fashion if you've got the link and you pay for it. I don't, so I'm not, but I guess that's probably the whole gist of it. I don't think streetwear is dying. Long live streetwear. It will never die. There will be kids that always want a t-shirt and a hoodie and a fucking, you know, snapback hat or something. But maybe within fashion it is kind of dying down. But also I'm a bit wary as to why fashion people seem so eager for it to die. There is something behind it. Maybe, again, like I said, is it dog whistling for all the, you know, minorities that have kind of infiltrated their scene? Is it just fashion people getting fed up? Because fashion in general is a fickle industry. They are quite trend-led. Maybe they're just fed up with that kind of trend and they want to move on to other things. That might be a thing too. But by and large, take it easy, fashion people. We're going to get out of your space. We're going to allow you to put, you know, godly amount of rhinestones back onto your jackets again. Don't worry. You know, we'll invite Flip Flynn back into the flipping room and let him give you another, you know, crazy leather jacket with cut up with different material sleeves on it again. So, like, do you remember when that was a big deal? That Philip Lynn jacket with the flipping sweatshirt sleeves on it. Like whoever still has that in their wardrobe, you best feel a lot of shame right now, because that jacket was horrendous. That I'd never got that. I think that was a Kanye thing, isn't it? Right, that was a Kanye thing. Did Kanye influence everyone to buy that jacket? Maybe it was Kanye, but that jacket was so bad. So bad. Yuck. Anyway, let's move on. Move on here. We have, Slam Jam Nike Blazers. These look so good. I think they came out, the original ones, I think, came out maybe a couple of years ago. There was a white pair I remember seeing before. As you guys are aware, Slam Jam, are they Milan based? I'm going to say Milan without looking at it. What, are they Milan? I think it might be Milan. I'm not too sure. Italian-based retail store. I knew about Slam Jam mostly because of Good Hood. No, mostly because of Hideout back in the day. I'm pretty sure the Hideout people were quite close with the people over at Slam Jam because some of the stuff that was getting imported or getting sent to the UK was probably then getting sent to Slam Jam. So a lot of cross-pollination there. I think the Slam Dad dude is quite entrenched in the scene. He's well known around people. I'm pretty sure I've seen all the regular scene people pop over to the store and hang out there. They seem to do some really cool activations as of late. I remember they did a thing with Heron and Virgil. They did some other things with Jay Lorenzo. They seem to have used their space as a real, like, kind of portal into the kind of youth culture in and around the area where the shop is. And by and large, I think nowadays you're seeing a lot of the retail stores and streetwear really expand what it means to be a retail store. No one's just, like, you know, keeping it to a brick and mortar store where you're just kind of buying brands. They're using it as a platform to showcase new talent, to take on new collaborations, to maybe introduce new product, to again be a voice, a mouthpiece, a platform for their local area, but also take their brand international. You're seeing a lot of shops doing pop-ups in other countries, which is a really cool idea. You know, you might go there and take some of your top brands who are local and take them to a new market, or you might use that opportunity to go to a new market to kind of get other kids to come out and basically spread the message. And especially nowadays with, like, you know, tier zero trainers and hype releases of clothing, there's only a certain amount of stores that have those kind of items anyway. So in order to kind of make sure you garner, you know, trust and a connection, because especially people in streetwear, we're loyal, right? If you do us wrong, obviously everyone's gonna, you know, there's certain brands I will never wear because I think the people that own it are cunts. But for the most part, if you're a good person and you are, if you're a brand that people resonate with, especially in the streetwear community, people will stick with you, you know, come hell or high water. So it's a good idea that Slam Jam are kind of expanding their, you know, portal and taking it international. And this is their second collaboration, I think so, and it's that blazer. I'm pretty sure they did a white one. It's Slam Jam Nike Blazer Class of 1997, dressed in black. And the thing I like about it most, of course, is the black and white shoes. So, you know, I'm always going to be down for it. Me and black and white shoes go together, like, you know, whatever. We just go together. So the thing I like about it the most is that it's black and white, obviously. So you got the white sole, black upper with a white swoosh. It's a classic 1970 blazer shape. So it's got the little front lip at the front. If you remember the Stussy blazer back in the day, not the blazer they have now, where it's sort of like completely chamfered. It's got the little bit of the lip at the front, which is nice, and it's got a little bit of the I'm gonna call it the ollie pads on the left, on the outside edges of the shoe, the little strips on the side, but they're probably not ollie patches, they're probably something else. But I like the overall shape. Again, if my feet weren't as fat as they are now, I'd definitely wear these, like, most often than not. I'd probably wear these over wearing, like, a pair of Converse 70s. I just think the shape looks better. I think how the swoosh sits on the side of the shoe looks really cool. But talking about the swoosh, the thing I like the best about them is that on the instep, the swoosh is upside down. Now, these came before, the Travis Scott Jordans, and they came, I think, just after the Off-White 10 collaboration. So some people might get a bit bored with the whole upside down and back way front swoosh stuff, but I'm not. I still think it looks crazy cool, crazy awesome. It reminds me of that, what was that Nike shoe back in the day the skate brand did, where they kind of cut off the Nike swoosh and they put a banana next to it? I think maybe that might have been during the era when skate shops were opposed to Nike SBs and didn't like the fact that Nike SB was basically, you know, twisting the arms of skate shops to make sure they only carried, I remember there was a time where Nike SB were very mafia-like in the way that people bought their shoes. You couldn't buy the hype ones. If you went to buy the hype ones, you had to buy the complete inline collection. And I think the inline collection is basically all the black and white shoes. So you had to buy the Dunk, Dunk Low, Dunk, Dunk Mid, Dunk High, all the Janowskis, like every single shoe. The thing is about 10 shoes in Nike SB's mainline collection that comes in black and white every season. And you have to buy all of them plus however many. You have to buy before you were allowed to get the hype, the kind of tier zero kind of Hyperstrike shoes. So I think I remember during the era, some brand decided to take the swoosh off a shoe. I'm pretty sure, I'm not talking out of turn. And they took it and they put a banana next to it on the side of it. I remember that was a big deal. I was like, that kind of reminds me of this sort of thing, you know? Like not taking your shoes too seriously, flipping it around, you know, having a bit of fun of it. And again, like I mentioned before, I'm happy about this era of collabs. It's like, you know, the collabs in this era aren't as crazy as they were back in the day. You know, nowadays, like, you can tell what a clock collaboration looks like. Nowadays, a clock collaboration sticks out a lot, right? Back in the day, when I used to buy a lot of sneakers, the clock collaboration was just, like, it would kind of disappear into the background. It wouldn't be that big of a deal because everyone was doing these fucking crazy paint-by-number colorways. Nowadays, it seems like brands, even if they only get one opportunity to collaborate with Nike or Adidas, whatever it may be, they take the opportunity to actually do something they actually want to wear, like something that they're actually passionate about. They go to the archives, they maybe select a model that's not that popular. I think of like a Martine Rose and her shoe that she put out. Do you know what I mean? I like that brands nowadays aren't just going for the, you know, the easy low-hanging fruit, right? On Air Max or Air Jordan 1. They're going for like crazy shoes that maybe won't stand the test of times in terms of trend, but something that the designer themselves actually wanted to do themselves, right? And I think this is what you're seeing with this sort of collaboration. Because if you're Slam Jam, you could have done whatever you wanted. You could have, you know, I'm pretty sure the Blazer has maybe, I wonder what the collection is with the Blazer with the shop as well, but it's just an interesting way to do it. I like the shoe, upside down swoosh on the inside, on the instep, sorry, and then you got Class and the 997 on the back tab. And then to make it even better, and I think this is what actually got me hyped about the shoe, is this cool little video for, they're gonna release it. So here, the text says the following: the Slam Jam Nike Class 997 in black, so it's set to release at Slam Jam. The only 97 pairs available before a limited run arrives at Nike sneakers platform. The raffle will run from November 9th to the 28th. The launch event will be in Los Angeles, and it'll feature the what do you call them, hardcore, death metal, I don't know, whatever you call horror. They are going to perform at the show on November, what is that, a secret event featuring horror. So this is the event here they're going to have on the 9th of November. And this video actually got me pretty hyped. So they're doing this in LA as well, which is, again, cool, isn't it? A shop based in Italy is doing a second, collaborating with Nike and launching a shoe in LA. I think it's pretty cool. This video really got me hyped. So it's basically a montage of horror playing some show somewhere. Loads of donuts in the middle of a parking lot, some guys putting up fly posters, loads of real cool LA scenery videos, loads of debauchery and, you know, crazy activities probably going on while this is happening. But yeah, Slam Jam, Commonwealth Projects, horror playing, Class 97 Night Dunks, or Air Blazers, sorry. So check that out if you're around the LA area and grab yourself a pair. And yeah, man, really cool collaboration. I like them. I'm a big fan. I think for all the stuff out there that I complain about, I think these are, again, one of the best out at the moment. Again, you know, I'm biased. I like black and white trainers, but, you know, shoot me. What can you do? Next on the list, what else do we have here? We have Kid Cudi Cactus Plant Flea Market hoodie. That looks really nice as well. I think it's glow in the dark. I'm pretty sure I saw it was glow in the dark sort of thing that I'm sure people will be more interested in. I'm not sure if he's dropping merch the same way that Yeezy dropping or Kanye dropping his merch, but I've seen quite a few Kid Cudi merch pieces here and there. I'm not sure if he's doing collaboration with a lot of different people, but so far so good. Cactus Plant Flea Market has been doing a pretty cool job when it comes to the hoodies and the graphic design and all that sort of stuff. I'm sure people are familiar with that brand and what they've been doing with Kanye and his album release, but I really like what it's did here. So you've got this it's sort of like a teal colorway hoodie. Is it teal green light blue with intergalactic Long Beach Kid Cudi 19, probably part of his tour, with stars adorning the entire hoodie. And then of course once you're in the dark, so it's called love, and at the back it's got love will guide us all, love will teach us, love will hurt us all, love will heal, love will find us all. So again, nice wholesome messages on the Cactus Plant, of course, merch. And then of course, when you turn off the lights in the light show, it all goes in the dark. Really cool, man. I love the design, I love everything about it. I love the fact that the words guide, teach, hurt, heal, and find are the only ones highlighted in the back as well. Really, really cool design. I'm really happy with that one. I'm really fond of this. This will also be available on the 5th. So that was yesterday. So probably sold out by now. 150 for those of you guys that are wondering. Made in the US and constructed of 14-ounce pigment dyed cotton. That's always a really good sign, isn't it? It's like pre-washed cotton hoodies that have gone through tons of treatment before they've even any sort of screen print is applied to it, so you get that real vintage worn in feel that everyone wants. The garment features a plethora of off puff printed stars on the chest, back, and sleeve. These are overlaid by a throwback style digital font and prints that include intergalactic blah blah blah. Okay, cool. The entirety of the print, blah, blah, blah. Yeah, blah. How do hypebeasts write so many words for a hoodie? That's amazing talent, be able to write that many words for a hoodie that glows in the dark. But anyway, but yeah, check that out. It's available now. For you guys that are wondering, that are fans of Kid Cudi like I am, there's definitely a bit of merch that you should be adding to your collection. That's one. Let's move on up. What else is on the list here? We've got a cool little article about the fall of the Berlin Wall that I saw from The Guardian. That was really awesome, because I think we're celebrating the 30th anniversary of the fall of the Berlin Wall. So there's loads of Berlin Wall commemoration pieces going up. There's exhibitions in London as well happening. There's exhibitions in Germany, of course, and all around the world. People are observing this monumental moment. And The Guardian put together this cool little article that is called We Finished Every Bottle, Berlin Cultural Legends of the Night That Fought the Wall Fell. So loads of people, you know, cultural icons, cultural legends. Got me thinking, you know, that's what I want to be. I want to be a cultural legend. I want to be a cultural icon. I want people to think back and look back at my life and think, oh shit, I did quite a lot, man. You contribute quite a lot to culture. You know what I mean? Maybe that's my dream. Maybe that's my goal. this article is really good. Anyway, it kind of highlights loads of cultural figures from Germany or who were integral to that scene. I like the fact that there's loads of expats there as well in the list, and not just kind of people from Germany, which kind of adds a little bit of a cool perspective to the whole issue. You got this amazing image here of everyone of bringing the halls down, a protest on top of the wall, loads of young people. I'll read a couple of these profiles because I think some of them were pretty cool, actually. I think you guys might get a kick out of them, and see if I can find the one I was talking about. Yeah, there's quite a few on here, actually, I want you guys to check out. So yeah, the first one is from a guy called Daniel Barenboim. He's a pianist and conductor who lived in Berlin since 1991 and is a leader of the Berlin State Opera. It says the following. I happened to be in a Berlin recording the Cosi Fan Tutti with the Philharmonica. The day after the wall fell, the orchestra asked if I would do a concert with them on Sunday morning, the 12th of November. I said yes, on the two conditions. It must be free and only citizens of East Germany. This is the day after. He kind of agreed to do one day after, which is quite cool. Imagine not knowing and you decide to do it such a monumental day. When I arrived at the hall, for a short rehearsal. Fans of people were queuing. Some arrived at 4 a.m. We played Beethoven's first piano concerto, 7th symphony, and a concerto and a Concy Fan Tutti overture. The joy and energy from these people and orchestra was unforgettable. It was much more than an appreciative audience of a wonderful orchestra. Afterwards, we were a lot of people backstage, but I needed to get ready for the next recording session. As I say goodbye, I noticed a lady of about 60 leaning against a wall with a young man about 30. I asked if I could help her. She shyly gave me a bunch of flowers and thanked me. "I have something to tell you," she said. This woman had got married 30 years early in East Berlin and had a son. But her husband fled to the West with their baby and she had no contact with them. She had lit a candle every night. But the day before the concert, a man knocked at her door. It took me quite a few seconds to realize that he was my son. They came to the concert to celebrate their reunion. It touched me enormously. I told her I would invite her to come anytime and play the concert in Berlin. She said, "No, Mr. Berman, I don't need any invitation. I'll just be there." That's amazing. After the concert, I asked if I would be his director. One of the first decisions I took was to hire a German musician from both sides. I'm conducting again this Saturday night at another free concert in front of the Brandenburg Gate. It'll be bring back the memories of a day that changed the whole world. Amazing, isn't it? How music can bring so many people together. Again, you've got a profile here of Uti Lemper, is an Olivier Award-winning German singer and actress who started in Chicago and original in Paris production of The Cabaret, which is awesome. There's a profile here from Wim Wenders who said there was no bananas left in West Berlin. And there's a really cool one here too. Of Mark Reeder, 61, a musician and a record producer from Manchester, actually, who was also in Berlin. And he says the following. He says, on my first trip to East Berlin, I collared a young new wave looking lad who had lilac drain pipes and spiky hair on the U-Bahn. I asked him about the music scene there and if there were any underground punk concerts. He shook his head. It turned out he was a Stasi informer. In his report, he said, "I was looking for a political underground. Punk was seen as an anti-state in those worker paradises and it was classified as subversive, dekmanted." Which isn't a bad accolade, which obviously, you know, you're probably familiar with that, having looked at the case of Posse Riot and how some countries just don't fuck around when it comes to this, you know, counterculture, underground, youth-led, questioning of authority type, you know, youth culture movements. They don't really play too many games of that sort of stuff. And I guess back in the day in East Berlin, the same thing happened there. So it continues later in 1989. I was back in the East to produce an album for the indie band Division in a state-owned recording studios. It was obvious East Germany had already started to fall apart. There were demonstrations of people were trying to get out. In early November, I decided to take a short break with some friends. Somehow, I took them into a road trip east of Bucharest. We left Berlin on a gloomy night on the 8th of November. Days later, in a Hungarian hotel along the way, I saw a photo on the front of the newspaper showing a man standing on top of the Berlin Wall, drinking a bottle of Skit. It confused me until I read the headline that said, "East German troops begin partial demolition of the wall." I thought, what? What wall? Oh, fuck. They mean the wall. It hit me like a hammer. We drove back to Berlin, which had completely changed. The streets were teamed with Trabants, those famous cars that you guys are aware of that kind of look a little bit like a buggy, like a Nissan Micro or something. They're kind of synonymous with Germany. The cars of East Germany, the mustache men in cheap tracksuit jackets and stonewashed jeans, which is probably a massive look nowadays. Just reminds me of, you know, Martin Rose collections and Vetements or Balenciaga. Women had their big hair, flowery leggings, and it was incredible, positive new energy. In early 1990, I managed to finish producing the Division album, which I called Torture. It became the soundtrack for many East German kids who had not been infected by the new sound of techno. That Stasi informer had thought I had some sort of political agenda to corrupt the youth of East Germany with Western music. How right he was. Awesome. So I recommend you check it out. I'll put a link in the show notes. Loads of cool profiles. I won't read them all for you. I don't want to bore you, but definitely some good information there. If you're as infatuated with Berlin as I am, you'll definitely get a lot of value from checking out some of these profiles in the Guardian. It's titled "We Finished Every Bottle: Berlin's Cultural Legends on the Night the Berlin Wall Came Down." It's on the Guardian. Again, I'll put a link in the show notes if you guys want to check it out. Definitely have a look through it if you can. So let's end that one. Let's close that. Let's see what else we want to talk about on this list. What else we got about here? Let's see. Oh, amazing article here on Tom Sachs, actually. How to be an artist 24/7. A really cool little profile on Tom Sachs interview sort of thing, because he's doing an exhibition, I think, in Berlin. Is it Berlin? Yes, in Berlin now. It's essentially a retrospective of sorts, a timeline of his, all the work that he'd done from the first piece of work that he put, that he kind of created, and until the present day. Again, you don't really see this too often from... but maybe it's a bit soon for Tom Sachs. I always thought he would kind of do this a little bit later down in his career. But he's done quite a few things. He's done the space program thing. He did a tea ceremony exhibition in Japan, in I think somewhere in Japan, that looked fucking incredible. So, you know, he's kind of ramping up that level. And of course, maybe off the back of the Nike collaboration, it might be a good time to kind of cash out. And if you can cash out in a good way and kind of exploit the opportunity spotlight that's on him at the moment and kind of reach a bigger audience, I'm all the best for it. And of course, being selfish that I am, and him being one of my favorite artists, I'd like him to stay a little bit more underground. But it's cool to see he's been able to do these kind of collaborations or these kind of exhibitions and kind of spread the message of Tom Sachs far and wide. So it's a really cool article from High Snobiety. Loads of really cool, interesting bits and pieces on it that I want to point out to you. But it's a really cool article. Essentially, it kind of a profile on Tom Sachs. You see him here in the studio, and loads of interesting pieces that he's put together now for the exhibition that's on at the moment, right? But there's two bits that I really wanted to pop out that really kind of spoke to me that I want to get to talk about here. So where's this one quote that I like? I think it's that one, isn't it? Yeah, this is where's the first quote that really got me, that I thought was awesome, from Mr. Tom Sachs, if I can find it. So let's go there. Boom. So this is a quote from Tom Sachs, right? Here we go. So it's the following. This is from the article, right? So it's Tom Sachs interview. It's on High Snobiety. Again, I'll link it in the show notes if you guys check it, but I'll read it right now quickly. So it says the following. While I haven't heard Sachs refer to himself as a bureaucrat, bureaucracy might be the modern ritual he's most fascinated with. One critic in a review of Sachs' elaborate space program installation at the Park Avenue Amory in 2012 wrote that it felt like a display of authoritarian whimsy. One could argue that there is a whimsy to everything Sachs does, the kind I imagine model UN participants proudly flaunting. However, sitting with Sachs and following him through his Byzantine studio and the wide egress of his thought process, this authoritarian approach seems like a self-defense mechanism, one that would allow him to be productive in spite of the quicksands of distraction and the self-doubt that would swallow up lesser creative minds. And Tom Sachs says the following, it's a quote I really like, right? It says, there are many ways of being an artist. Sure. But for me, the biggest one is about building my life. Eating, sleeping, fucking, working out, and getting my teeth cleaned. My hair cut, sharpening my chisel, and making sure that I have red paint for when the moment strikes. It's about preparing for the moment, Sachs says. Because it's elusive and it's very, very small. And that made me think, right? That's essentially what happens. I think you hear a lot of people, especially when I read, I think I've got the book here that I mentioned quite a few times. It's called Rituals. I've got who written it, but it's called Daily Rituals, sorry. It's an amazing book that essentially covers or profiles or details the daily rituals of loads of influential figures in culture, from art, literature, whatever you may name it. They're all in that book. And one thing that you see from all the rituals that everyone has, what they do is that they prepare their days or the hours before they get to work so that it allows them to do the work they need to do. So they just have some sort of structure in place, whether it's waking up really early, whether it's having a cigarette in the morning, whether it's going for coffee, whether it's working out. They do certain things in the morning that naturally will trigger other things. Like in the morning when I wake up, I have things that trigger other actions. One of my actions I have trigger in the morning is waking up early, waking up before 6 a.m. so that the first thing I do is I don't eat breakfast that early anyway. I'm usually fasting. I go straight to the gym, I come back home, I shower, have breakfast, record my podcast, go to work, come back, do a mix, write something, journal, whatever it may be. Do you know what I mean? So each thing triggers the next thing. So if you're a professional writer, you will do all the things I do up until you come back home and shower, and then you get straight into writing, because that's what you've done. You set your day up where you do those three or four tasks in the beginning that then allows you and triggers you into the whole creative part. Because I think like Tom Sachs mentioned, that time or the event or the time and place where you're suddenly inspired or you have a stroke of genius, it's only going to come about when you're in that kind of mode of working, right? So you need to be prepared for it. You need to be able to kind of grab that bolt of lightning out from the sky, package it and kind of write, or kind of scribble it down on a bit of paper so you don't forget it. But it's so fleeting. For the most part, you're just generally going for the motions, right? You're not necessarily doing anything great. How many times have you sat in front of your screen with the cursor flicking in front of you, thinking about what to write, and then you sit there, you write something for about an hour, you really batch yourself, you're like, oh my God, this is the worst thing ever. Happens all the time. Because what you're doing day by day is that you're training yourself just to start writing. You don't necessarily have to write, you know, like Ernest Hemingway the first time, or you won't necessarily do it. But what you're doing is that you're building up a practice so that suddenly when that source of, when that kind of stream of inspiration comes along, you are ready because you're at your desk, as opposed to being somewhere else that doesn't, you know, you're nowhere near a desk, you're nowhere near anything to write with, and then suddenly inspiration strikes and you think you're gonna remember it, and as per usual, like, you try to remember dreams, it never fucking happens. So I like the fact that he's like so regimented and so kind of, you know, bureaucratic, as the author pointed out, even with the 10 bullets HR video that essentially tells you how to prepare your studio, how to clean up, how to open up, how to close down. It's very by the book. It's like, you have to do these things. Like, these things have to be done no matter what, so that the other things you want to do can happen. It's sort of like a delayed gratitude. It's sort of like discipline. You know what it reminds me of? Discipline equals freedom. The Jocko Willink quote. The Jocko Willink quote that I have at the back of my board there. From the obstacles, discipline equals freedom is from The Obstacles Away, right? Or no, what book is that from? It's from one of these books anyway. But that's one of the quotes I like, right? Discipline equals freedom, right? The more disciplined you are, the more free you are to the things that you want to do. And it allows you to do other things too, in general, right? Even when it comes to fitness, even when it comes to health, even when it comes to just working, right? How many times at work have you put off a couple of projects and then suddenly they all come piling on top of you? And then you start stressing yourself out. Whereas if you discipline yourself to do them before you even head home, even if that means you having to stay a couple of hours, that then means you are freeing yourself up later on down the week to kind of, you know, not be so stressed, go home a little bit earlier, maybe do a couple more edits before the final handing comes around. There's loads of things that kind of hit. So that's one of the quotes that really stood out to me in that article. And then the second one, I think, was the end bit, right? What's the end bit? I think that's it, isn't it, for the quote? But yeah, I recommend you check it out. It's a really cool interview with Tom Sachs. It's on High Snobiety. He speaks very, very eloquently and clearly about his approach to design, his approach to creativity. And I think for the most people, especially for creatives like myself, who are, you know, you tend to struggle with how you do things, and you tend to struggle more so with just starting or how you're going to start. Whereas, you know, this topic or this interview kind of is a good way of kind of telling you what it means to be an artist, an actual professional artist. It means to kind of just turn up and do the work. It means to show up every single day. As long as you show up, the work will then follow. Especially if you're showing up with something that you love, it shouldn't be work anyway. But if you are struggling to get that first bit of inspiration, make that first step, I really recommend checking out this interview with Tom Sachs. It is titled, in High Snobiety, Tom Sachs' Entire Life is Art. It's available now on High Snob. But again, I'll link in the show notes for you guys to check out yourselves, and you can see it for yourself. Anyway, that's it for me. It's an hour in. Thanks so much for tuning in to Agostinho Zinga Show, episode number 246. As always, for more information regarding myself, click the link in the show notes, agostinhozinga.com. That's the home of moi. You can find all the links to my social media, my DJ mixes, my blog, everything you can find on there. If you want to reach out and send me an email, you can do that on there too. And I'll check you guys again on the other side for an episode of the show. But until then, take care, peace, and see you later.